Hi everyone, Jeff MacArthur here, and I'm not actually doing another review right now, nor am I doing another vlog. I am instead redoing my review of Change in Management by RJ Johnson. And the reason I'm doing it is, first of all, there was a technical problem last time where the camera just started shaking, or actually it was just the video screen started shaking at the end. Plus, I wasn't particularly satisfied with what I was saying about the review and some of the things I was saying at the end, so I'm just going to go through it again here. First of all, I was trying to find the way to describe this book as I was reading it, because it's one of those books that, it's one of those stories in general that starts very simply but gets more and more complex as it goes along. And, you know, basically you can only go so far before you start going into spoilers, and it would take a really long time to go into, like, what really goes into this story. So instead, I'm just going to read the back to you to give you an idea of, you know, what the plot is. So anyway, murder, betrayal, the fate of humanity. It's all in a day's work for Jim Meade, Martian PI. In 2097, humanity is ruled by two major powers, the Consortium and Coalition. But Jim Meade is a runabout, someone who doesn't care who's running the show so long as he can earn his keep peacefully in the deadly zero-G fights that keep the Martian colonists entertained on a nightly basis. After one of his fights goes horribly wrong, Meade finds himself deep in debt to one of the most dangerous warlords on Mars. When a beautiful Coalition officer asks to help clear her father's name, he seizes the opportunity to make some easy money. Yeah, pretty much what is in the story is described there. It's one of those things where a mystery turns into another mystery, turns into another mystery, and so on and so forth, so it becomes more and more complex until, and not Game of Thrones type complex. It's not like a lot of characters with a lot of different things going on. It's pretty much just this guy gets into more and more trouble, and he has, one of the things that's amusing about this character, really sets him as a character, is he has a big mouth, and he keeps saying the wrong things, and it's what makes him both heroic and just keeps getting him in trouble, because he says what he's not supposed to, and sometimes it's something that should be said, but nobody's saying it, and he says it, and then he gets in more trouble. And other times, he just simply has a big mouth and gets him into more trouble. That's what's amusing about him, all that sort of thing. What really makes this story work, and what really makes this book work in general, and probably this whole series, I'm only reviewing the first book, but there's a whole series to it, is the science fiction elements are fantastic. A lot of times when people do science fiction, or fantasy for that matter, they put things in because, well, hey, I can do whatever I want, or I can put, you know, these other mystical, amazing items in, or these great science fiction elements in, I'm just going to throw them in because they're cool, or because they'll work for this certain action scene, or whatever. With this world, what he creates on Mars, it really feels like these things would exist whether the story was happening or not. You could take Jim Meade out of it, and like these things would exist. They're very organic. They really work in terms of things on Mars. I believe this world exists. That really makes the story work, and it really makes the whole world work and the whole feel of it work. It's the sign of really, really good science fiction. What didn't work for me, and what was I found was kind of a problem, and this is kind of one of the reasons I wanted to redo the review, because I think I probably came off a little overly harsh on it, but it can really be said in the description here. It says, when a beautiful Coalition officer, and that, in my opinion, is kind of how the women come across in this story. It's not that the story is sexist, it's like blatantly sexist. I mean, it even says, beautiful Coalition officer. Okay, she's a Coalition officer. She can, you know, live without the main character and still be really tough and all that sort of thing. However, unlike the science fiction elements in this, I don't see any of the main female characters existing outside of the main plot. It's like they're there to service the main character. And I don't mean service in a way like they're actually in some way serving him in the story. But plot-wise, I don't see them existing outside of this story. I'd feel like they're not handled with as much depth. They're handled as, you know, strong characters, but I don't see them existing outside of these stories in a way, if that makes any sense. And, you know, I mean, like, for instance, the reason I read this in the back of the description, when it describes him, Jim Meade, Martian PI, it's describing what he does, what his career is. With her, yeah, it says what she does as a career Coalition officer, but of course it has to start with the beautiful. And the whole book kind of has that sort of feel. It's not blatantly sexist. It doesn't act like, oh, women can't do things or whatever. They're perfectly capable in this and all that sort of thing. But it does stop to go to go like, here's a description of what she looks like. It stops to describe how beautiful the women are, oftentimes, and the men is more about what they're doing. And I wasn't crazy about that. That was something about the book that I really wasn't particularly, that I wasn't partial to. It's not horrible. It doesn't ruin the book or anything like that. It's just an element that I hope got better in the next books in the series. Because like I say, this is a series. This is just the first book. Hopefully that element fades out. Anyway, so the other thing that I want to use kind of as a lesson to folks is I was making a lot of the same, this particular same mistake as Mr. Johnson is in this book. And by the way, I should add to this, he's actually doing very, very well with these books. So some of this, you know, take for whatever it's worth, but these are improvements that could be made to the book. In terms of formatting, you'll notice just sort of, there's no style to the chapter name. There's not, you know, it's not down in the middle of the page, and there's like gaps between the paragraphs, and it's very rough down, you know, in the bottom. Now, here's the thing. I was making these mistakes as well, so I'm, you know, it'll seem a little bit like I'm a hypocrite for criticizing this, but basically this was pointed out to me by an editor. I ended up having to pay, you know, a whole lot of money to get an editor at one point, and basically got a lesson in publishing that the formatting is supposed to be, first of all, straight on both edges. You're not supposed to have the gaps between. You're supposed to basically have an indentation. You're supposed to have like a, you know, the chapter name should be partway down and, you know, bigger than the rest of the writing and stuff like that. What this formatting is basically Kindle. You can upload it directly like that, and I'll bet you anything, because as I understand it, most of his sales are on Kindle. So he probably had this formatted like that, put it out, and just took the formatting directly from Kindle and put it right onto the paperbacks and printed them that way, because it looks just like that. And I'm just basically letting you know, you're not supposed to do that. You're supposed to actually reformat for paperbacks, all that sort of thing. Again, he's doing perfectly well with this kind of formatting, but it's better for us as independent publishers, you know, to do the formatting. You know what, let me just get out a regularly published book to kind of give you an idea. This is the way that it's supposed to look. Just a moment here. Yeah, so you can see sharp edges along the sides and paragraphed and all that sort of thing. So that's a more professional looking book. It didn't ruin my experience with that, and I think people who have huge problems and look at that sort of thing and they're like, oh, I can't read that. That's an independently published book because, you know, and it just ruined the whole experience for me. I say, get over it. It's not that big of a deal. But to publishers, independent publishers, yeah, you really should format as, you know, as professionally as you can. Anyway, like I say, not a huge problem with the book, but just something to be aware of as independent publishers. I want this as much as possible to be a learning experience as much as it is a review site. Anyway, definitely recommend it. You know, just had that one story problem with some of the female characters, but it's not blatantly sexist or problematic or anything. But Change in Management by R.J. Johnson. Check out this book, check out the series, all that. Now, here's the other thing that I wanted to get across. First of all, I'm not going to be doing too many of these for a while. Basically, I found that I was having to choose between doing this and doing Relic Worlds. And especially after I was at WonderCon, I really found I need to spend more time on WonderCon, on Relic Worlds. I really need to build that up. I need more books coming out, more short stories. I really need to spend my time on that. And I really need to focus on that. I do believe in this channel. I want to support other independent authors. I want to support other independent publishers. I really want to get the word out about these great independent books coming out. Especially because when I went to YouTube to see about people reviewing my books, I found a bunch of booktubers, which is what they call themselves, who were self-publishing their videos, but they would not review any self-published authors. To them, there was something about, well, once you're, you know, it's okay for us to self-publish our videos, but when you work in the written word, well, that's just not valuable enough. We're you know, there. In fact, one person made an argument of, you know, well, I read a few self-published books, and they weren't very good, so I won't read any more. And it's like, well, I saw a few bad YouTube shows. Does that mean I shouldn't watch your show? All YouTubers and all, all bloggers, they're all self-published. But yet, there are a lot of them who have this very snobbish attitude of, well, we're not going to look at any independent books, especially when you are a booktuber. You're self-publishing on YouTube, and you're recognizing that the written word is important. So you're recognizing that independent artists are important by being on YouTube. You're recognizing that the written word is important, but you're not understanding the connection of those two. And that hypocrisy is absolutely stunning. And so I found myself complaining a lot, and then realized, you know what, I shouldn't complain if I'm not going to do anything myself. So this channel is a way to try to combat that, to say, hey, other independent authors and some others as well, they're really good, and they have some very important things to say. So I started doing this. I started doing it as reviews, and I started doing it as vlogs. It was also a weight loss thing for me. I was reading while I was walking, but I found that I wasn't keeping up with that, which is why I'm not bothering to do that. But, you know, I was like, this is a way of me doing my part. Unfortunately, what's ended up happening is like 5 people watch, or what'll happen is there'll be some people who will watch a video on the one book that they wrote or their friend wrote or something like that, and then they won't watch the next video. They'll only watch their own. And the only way we're going to do this, folks, is by standing together, is by all of us going, hey, we're all independent artists. You know, we need to get it out there to people that we have important things to say and we have important voices. Every bit as important, at the very least, as other YouTubers, other self-published people in other mediums. What we're saying is equally important. So, you know, we all need to support each other. We all need to be there for one another. And this is my way of doing that. And I'm a bit of a hypocrite because I'm saying I'm going to be backing down on this. But the simple fact was, you know, I'd do this and it was like each person would watch their own video and then not any others. And we need to, you know, we need to be watching each other's and supporting one another's. For the time being, I'm not going to make it in Relic Worlds if I'm doing this as much. And I, like I said, I thought I could do this in addition. I found out that that's actually hurting. In fact, right now I should be doing a Relic Worlds short story. I actually went away from it to do this review. So I need to go and concentrate on that, but I encourage all of you to do what you can to get out there and not just talk about your own book, but talk about other independent books that are really great out there. And don't just try to sell your own while then not reading other people's. Don't put up YouTube's videos being self-published and then be like, oh, but people who do the written word, they're not, you know, important. Their voices don't deserve to be heard. Don't self-publish your own books and then not read other self-published books. We have to stand together on this. So I'm still going to come back. I'm still going to do these videos because I still strongly believe in this. But I encourage all of you to do these types of things. I won't consider it to be competition. I'll be watching you because I want there to be more of these channels about independent publishing, independent writing, all of that. I want to see all of that from other people, and I will be a fan, and I'll be sitting there watching that. All you need to do is tell me about it, and I will be there. I would rather see other people do this rather than me, because I'm not very good at this. And in fact, I'm a slow reader. I'm a faster writer, but I am a really, really slow reader. As you could probably tell, as I was stammering through that, that's my trouble writing. I actually have a small amount of dyslexia. But anyway, I will continue to do what I can because I just don't see a lot of other people doing it, but I really encourage all of you, get out there and support other authors and do videos about it, do blogs about it, talk about independent writing and not just your own, other people's. It's the only way we're going to get respect out there. Anyway, that's all I have for now. Hopefully I'll be back sometime soon, and just keep on reading independent books. Thank you for watching.